Hello, I'm Rashid Stevens, and you're watching The Crystal Beauty Show, live here in Hollywood. Awesome show, awesome host, awesome everybody, even awesome me.
Welcome to The Crystal Beauty Show. Welcome to the Crystal Beauty Show. Today with us, we have Mr. Victor Vio. He's a household name, an African filmmaker who has won a lot of awards recently on his movie, Nina's Diary. We are very honored to have him as the guest in this episode of the show. You don't want to miss it, so stay tuned. Welcome to the Crystal Beauty Show. How are you doing?
I'm great. Thank you very much. Thanks for having me on.
Thank you for coming. I've been wanting to interview like for forever. You know, I'm glad you're finally here.
Thank you.
So, since the release of Nina's Diary, should we say that you haven't slept yet?
Yes, in a good way. You know, before the release of Nina's Diary, I hadn't slept either, but not in a good way. This time around, it's because one has been really busy. So it's been wonderful.
Great, great. So you recently went to New York for the screening of Nina's Diary. How was the reaction from the fans and viewers?
Oh, it was excellent. You know, one way for me at least to gauge reaction is how the Q&A goes afterwards. And it was very passionate. No one left the theater after the screening. Everyone stayed behind for the Q&A, and we were actually kicked out of the hall. And we stayed kind of at the entrance. We got kicked out of the entrance again, and we stayed in the main lobby. And I was talking to people 3 hours after the screening. So it was wonderful.
Wow. So remind us, how many awards has this movie gotten so far?
It has won at least 30, more than 30 awards so far.
Wow.
That it has won, yes.
Wow.
You know, national, international awards, yes.
And how does that make you feel?
It's humbling, you know, because I didn't expect all of this kind of attention. In fact, when we were making the movie, we didn't even think that we would be able to finish the film. So to see, you know, the kind of, you know, attention that it has gotten, you know, all the achievement it has received, you know, I think it's humbling, and I'm happy, not for myself, but I'm happy for the actors, you know, the crew, the sacrifices that they made over the years, because it didn't take us a short time to make this film. So I'm happy for all of them, you know, I'm glad that at least they were rewarded for all the sacrifices.
Nice. So what was the inspiration behind this movie?
The movie is actually it's inspired by a true story. You know, my cousin actually called me once when I was visiting Cameroon trying to raise money for a different movie. She insisted on seeing me. And when I went over, she told me this, you know, this like horrible story of what happened to her. And it was shocking because these were things that happened to her in my village, you know, where I grew up. And I grew up in this place. I knew these people. And she recounted how her husband was abusive, you know, like he would beat her from 2 miles, you know, that like, we're talking about beating that almost rival like a sporting event. Nobody would say anything, you know. So that really stayed with me.
So when you look back at all the achievements and awards that you've gotten, how does it make you feel?
Oh, it's just humbling, you know.
Yeah.
The tough thing about the achievement and the awards is that, you know, I'm glad that the film is getting attention. I'm glad that the work is getting attention. I'm glad that, you know, the cause is getting attention, you know. It's kind of double-edged because, you know, I would rather get attention for something else, maybe a more upbeat movie, you know. So it's tough, you know. I really can't feel too, I don't feel too good in terms of that, you know. It's a tough thing that happens, you know.
Yeah.
It's a tough situation, you know. So people always come to me and say that, wow, you know, It's very powerful. It's unfortunate that it had to be. And that's how I feel, you know. I'm glad that, you know, it's getting the attention, but it's unfortunate that a movie like this had to be made. But I feel like I was compelled. It had to be made.
Okay.
Yes.
So what are the plans for this movie? Like, where do you want this movie to go?
Oh, I would love for it I would love for as many people to see the movie as possible, especially in Cameroon. And right now, the next step is it's going to play in a couple of places. It's going to play in Canada and in Germany.
Okay.
I actually have been the one who stopped sending it out because people have been requesting it. So I'm trying to figure out a kind of a distribution mode, you know, to get the movie out there. I don't just want to, like, sit on it and then be sending out just to festivals, you know. I would like for it to actually be seen by as many people as possible. And there's also the possibility after the New York screening that the UN might be, you know, might screen the film. So if that happens, you know, again, that's going to be, I think, great, because the whole goal is to get as many people to see the film as possible, you know, to try to affect change.
Wow. Congratulations once more.
Thank you very much.
So tell us about your plans on screening this movie back in Cameroon.
Right now, we've partnered with Gopher, René Etat, and we're hoping that, you know, the film gets screened in Cameroon. The plan currently is to get a sponsor, because it costs money to, like, you know, screen the film there, you know, to get a sponsor, because I don't know how much support we can count on from the government. I'm not that well connected. I'm hoping that, you know, the government, you know, either the Ministry of Culture, the Ministry of Women's Affairs, you know, some of those ministries, you know, I hope we can work together and screen the film, you know, hopefully do a launch this year and possibly next year during Women's Month. I would love to see something where, you know, the Ministry of Women's Affairs says, okay, hey, we want to show this film, you know, in honor of women and set up screenings all over the country in all the regions. You know, I would love to see something like that happen. You know, so we're working on it. We definitely want the film to launch in Cameroon this year because it has been too long.
I know.
Yes.
So for our viewers who want to watch this film, how can they watch it? Where can they grab a copy?
Right now it's tough. It's not yet out. Okay. You know. But then the thing is, they can let me know on Facebook. You know, they can get in touch with us and let us know. Because what I would love to do is, even if I can secure an outside distributor, I'm very open to self-distributing. Mm-hmm. I would love to pick, you know, 10, 15 U.S. cities, you know, in the North America, you know, maybe some cities in Canada, maybe some cities in Europe, and set up screen, you know, maybe rent space. And then let people know, because the key is if people will show up, you know.
Yeah.
I don't just want to set up a screening and nobody shows up. If people will show up to the screening, 100 people, 150 people, 200 people, I will set up screenings all over the U.S. and have the film shown there. We'll probably have to go through that process before we get to the point where we kind of do, like, you know, like streaming online or DVD. You know, we have to exhaust that, the possibility of, like, theatrical distribution.
So when you did this movie, Nina's Diary, I'm very sure there were specific people that were very instrumental to making this project a reality. Who are those people and what would you like to tell them?
Oh, first of all, it's a big thank you to everyone who contributed to making the film possible. You know, it's tough to call names and leave out some people, but I'll go ahead and just name some people that I've not mentioned very often.
Yeah.
You know, I'll start with my wife. You know, she was there from the very beginning. She helped when we were trying to put, you know, the funds together. I'll mention Hasu Patel, you know, who came in with the first investment. Hasu Patel came with the first investment. I'll mention Roland, who came in, you know, with the second investment. These were key times when we've been struggling for months, for a couple of years, you know, trying to get funders and there was nobody coming in. So it was key for them. I'll also mention my friend in England, you know, Dr. Ndumu, you know, Abongwa, we call him Zico. He, at a very crucial point, when everything had come to a standstill, you know, I had tried I've gone to Cameroon several times to film, so many obstacles that stopped me from filming, and he called and he offered, you know, that if I could find, you know, if I could get myself together and get myself to Cameroon, he will get me money to film. And he did. He held on to his word and he sent me money, without which we would not have filmed, you know. And I also mentioned my editor, you know, Andrew Groves. He believed in the project. When I came back from Cameroon, believe it or not, I could not buy a pencil. I could not afford to buy a pencil. But I handed him the film and I told him that, listen, we need a cut within 3 weeks in order to apply for post-production funding. And somehow he was the one who bought, you know, drives. He bought everything and set everything up and cut the film. You know, he cut it and within 3 weeks we had a rough cut, you know. So people like that who believed in the project, you know, Daniel Tan, who came in when we picture locked and we didn't have any way to go, any more money to move forward. We had it on the shelf for a year. Daniel Tan read about us, you know, on the GFI blog, and he watched the film and he loved what we had done so far, and he came up with ideas. You know, he not only put his own money in it, but he helped us come up with ideas like in terms of crowdfunding and pushed that, you know. So all those people, his family in Singapore, you know, who helped to make this possible, you know, people all over, you know. There's so many people that I would love to thank, you know, Anurin, Vivian, you know. People that, you know, everybody, Wilson, there were so many people, you know, thank you for making it possible.
Okay. So now that you're done with Nina's Diary, do you have any other projects in the shelf that you want to work on next?
Absolutely. I actually have the project that I was trying to put together before Nina's Diary. It's called 50-50.
Mm-hmm.
We're thinking about changing the name to Njangi because there was a Hollywood movie that came out a few years ago named 50-50. But it's about a U.S. educated woman who returns to her village to find that when her dad died, her mom's house was taken away because women cannot inherit property. So in trying to recover the house, she ends up organizing a women's rebellion against the chief and the men of the village.
Wow.
So that's the one that I really am like bent on making next.
Mm-hmm.
But I do have a documentary called The Photograph that I'm in the process of making right now. We got backing from Hot Dogs Blue Eyes in Toronto.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a little bit of money to make the film. And I think that it's very timely because it deals with, like, you know, the Islam and Christianity, given what's been happening, you know, in Nigeria and Cameroon. It's funny because 2-3 years ago when I was putting the project together, in application, I was talking about Boko Haram and groups like that, and people thought I was crazy. You know, they thought, I mean, because at the time they were just like, you know, a small, you know, group on the edge.
Mm-hmm.
You know, nobody really paid attention to them, and look at what is happening right now.
So, tell us how you got into filmmaking.
Oh, that's a good one. How I got into filmmaking. I remember the first image, you know,
mm-hmm.
when as a film image I had, it was with my father, you know,
okay.
in Limbe. I don't know, people might remember, some people, this might date me as well. There was a cinema hall in Limbe called Potokri.
Mm-hmm.
It was right next to a field, you know, like football field, a stadium.
Yeah.
Yes. And I remember the first image was that, it was a close-up of a cowboy. And I was amazed. I was with my father. And I remember that very powerfully because that was the last image. That's the last image I have of my father when he was alive. So he passed away, you know, after that.
Mm-hmm.
And but the joy, the passion, the love of film continued. I didn't know that, you know, one could study filmmaking. So when I came to the U.S., I came to study electrical engineering. You know, but I remember when I was in college, I was buying, you know, books at the bookstore, and I saw a section that said screenwriting. I'm like, what? So I took a screenwriting class, and I could not believe that people got credit for that.
Yeah.
And I felt like, wow, this was it for me. So afterwards, you know, I kind of slowly moved away, you know, from engineering. When I graduated, you know, I went to, I got a scholarship to study creative writing. And then after that, I went to film school, you know. So it's been a long journey, you know, but I'm glad I took it.
Nice. So what is your relationship with Hollywood? Have you worked on any Hollywood movies yet?
I can say, yeah, I've worked with Hollywood, you know, but it's not really in the sense that, you know, I've made a Hollywood movie.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I shot a film here in L.A., you know, in 2005. It's called Doing the L.A. Thing,
okay.
You know. So that's probably as active as I've been in Hollywood. I work, you know, at a studio where we prepare digital cinema packages for screening, you know, so we watch all the big movies before they come and we make sure that everything is fine. So that's how, you know, that's really the closest relationship I have with Hollywood. You know, at the moment, because of 50-50, we're trying to see if we can get some people, you know, we have some partners in Hollywood who are like on board to support us to try to make it happen. So, yeah, you know, but I'm not so focused about like Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I am here. You know, maybe I should maybe focus a little bit more about that. But my interest is in telling, you know, moving stories, especially Africa-themed stories, you know, stories that are set in Africa, you know. If Hollywood can help me do that, that would be wonderful. They had trouble with, you know, 50-50 because after film school, my short film, Butuku, was doing very well. You know, it was nominated for a Student Academy Award. It premiered in Venice. You know, it was almost every festival wanted the film. And then I had the script, you know, that also won an award and, you know, was doing quite well. Except Hollywood didn't know what to do with an African film. You see, that's why, you know, I still have the script, you know. It's still not made because they were like, what do we do with this? Do you have something else, you know?
Yeah.
Maybe if I was smart, I would have come up with an idea to shoot here in Hollywood, you know. Maybe that's what it is. But I went with my heart and my heart said that, you know, make a movie about Africa, make a movie that has, you know, some substance to it.
So, in the recent interview you did in New York, you mentioned something about training. So, can you tell us more about that? How do you intend to do that?
Ideally, I would love to set up a program in Cameroon, especially because I am from Cameroon.
Yeah.
But it's going to be kind of tailored, you know, for all of Africa. You know, mm-hmm. anyone in Africa who's interested in filmmaking, you know, they can come in there and study and learn filmmaking. And I want it to be a program that has both sex, that's open to almost everyone. People who are educated and people who don't have as much education as they would want, you know, because there are people who don't have the education already, who still have talent in filmmaking. You know, I think they should be able to, like, you know, learn the craft and, you know, practice it, you know. And there are people who want to have, like, degrees in, you know, certificates in filmmaking, you know, and they've gone through, I don't know, O-levels, A-levels, you know, the back and maybe first degrees, and they want to, like, you know, go even further in filmmaking, you know. So I want that to be the kind of program I want to set up. The kind of training I want to set up would be geared towards everyone. But then, I think that what would be great is my idea is to try to get people that I know in Hollywood, you know, get in touch with my film school and see what kind of backing, what kind of support I can get, so that people who are here, you know, professors, you know, filmmakers, can come in to Cameroon. You know, maybe they can come on a vacation, you know, in the summer, you know, and then maybe teach a master class at our film school, you know, or, you know, things like that, you know, make it open so that, you know, it's the training is kind of, you know, international, you know, whether the, you know, professionals from Europe, from the US, Canada, other parts of Africa, you know, they can come in, you know, train, you know, give, whether it's master class or maybe courses, you know, one semester at a time, you know, and also kind of have an exchange program where film students can come and spend time at my alma mater, you know, and then, you know, for a semester or a summer, you know, take classes and then go back to Cameroon. Maybe professors too can come and spend time and just figure out how professors here teach courses and then go back, you know. So I would love something like that. You know, I want a situation where we build a talent pool in terms of technicians, you know, where it's seamless, where people, you know, if a Hollywood movie wants to shoot in Cameroon, you know, they don't have to worry about technicians. The technicians that they have there should be at the same caliber as the technicians that are working in Hollywood. You know, because we have everything. Cameroon is a rich country. We have, you know, whether it's ocean, you know, beaches that we have, mountains, you know, rainforests, we have everything, you know. So, but the only thing we don't have is snow, you see. So, the terrain, we have desert, whatever they want to shoot, you know. So, people can come and shoot their films, commercials, you know, kind of, you know, the way that, you know, people do it in, like, South Africa, you know. So, why not Cameroon, you know? That's kind of the goal, that's kind of what I'm hoping for.
Nice. So, when you're not doing film-related things, what else do you do with your spare time?
Oh, I have a family. So I spend time with my boys, you know, and then it's tough because almost everything is film-related. I'm either doing film or I'm reading novels, I'm reading, you know, stories or writing. Usually, you know, when I'm in Cameroon, that's usually when, you know, sometimes I step away from, you know, film because I'm into, like, I'm kind of a farmer. I'm kind of a farm boy, you know, kind of thing. So I love cattle, you know. So I raise cattle, you know. So I have that, you know. So that's kind of what, you know, I'm passionate about, raising cattle, you know. Yes.
Okay. Well, thank you so much. So do you have any last words for our Cameroonian film lovers watching this right now?
Absolutely. I mean, my advice is, you know, keep watching movies. Keep, especially, please, please, please support Cameroonian movies. Support African films in general. If you hear that there's a Cameroonian movie, please find a time to come out. Because it's been kind of, it saddens me, you know, to see that when you go to events, you don't find Cameroonians. I'm sorry. We were at the Lincoln Center, you know, we screened the film at the Lincoln Center. There was one Cameroonian present in the audience afterwards, you know, when we talked to him. One. You know, and there was another screening for, there was a film for, I think it was from Guinea-Bissau or something like that. And let me tell you, the audience was filled with people from Guinea-Bissau. You know, you could see them, they came out, they celebrated their country, they celebrated their film, you know. It's not like, you know, it's not about the filmmaker. It's about the people, it's about the culture, it's about, you know, this is us, you know. And if we don't support us, who do we expect, you know, to support us, you know? If we want to take our film, if we want to take our industry, our films to the next level, it has to start with us, you know. It has to start with us. Almost every community in the world supports their own. If an Indian film opens in the US, guess what? You see Indians at the screening. You know, a friend of mine who is a filmmaker from Uganda, I don't think it's an African thing, you know, unfortunately it might be a Cameroonian thing.
Yeah.
Because a friend of mine who is from Uganda, he said that he screened his film in Boston, and it was set up by Ugandans. They paid for everything. You know, they paid for advertising, they paid for the hall, you know, they did everything. All he did was show up with film and the room, the theater was packed, you see. It would be amazing if Cameroonians can support other Cameroonians, not just film, whatever it is, music, whatever it is, literature, whatever it is, you know. Cameroonians should support Cameroonians. You know, Africans should support Africans, you know. And because that's where it starts, you know, I think. Yeah. You know, if you can't count on your own, you know, who can you count on? So please, you know, just go out there, support. They're trying, you know, other filmmakers are trying to make the best film that they can. You know, support them, the quality will only improve.
So what do you think about our Cameroonian film industry?
Well, I'm always hopeful.
Okay.
You see, mm-hmm. I'm always hopeful. I know that there's this great, you know, interest. You know, there's like people are passionate. People are passionate about, you know, filmmaking in Cameroon. People are enthusiastic. Young people are like, you know, pushing, you know, to make movies, you know. But then the only thing, my main concern is just that, you know, people should get training, you know. You know, because I think almost in any craft, you know, people train before they release, you know. Filmmaking is one of the few places where, you know, people just get up from whatever they're doing and they go out and they make a movie, you know, because they think that they can, you know. And I don't know, I'm sure there are rare cases where people do that and they're successful, you know. But please, you know, train, because training can only improve, you know, the process. And I mean, there are other issues in the industry that, you know, they're dealing with, you know, and I think that it's just with time that they're going to figure out, you know, and resolve some of these issues.
So, just to thank you for being on the show, the Chris Abidi Show, you know, and the team would like to give you this as appreciation.
Oh, thank you very much.
For you being here.
Merci beaucoup. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Oh, it looks very nice. Excellent. Crystal Beauty Show.
I hope you love the interview. Mr. Victor definitely is going to be on the show again because he has a lot of projects coming up. As usual, thank you so much for your time. Follow us on Twitter, like our Facebook page. And until next time, this is Crystal saying bye-bye.